Good afternoon, friends, and welcome to the EDUSAT Network. Our today's topic of discussion is internationalism and cosmopolitanism in India. And for this discussion, we have with us in our studio Dr. Satish Kumar Jha, Associate Professor, Department of Political Science, Aryabhatt College, University of Delhi. His area of specialization is Indian politics and political thought, and he has been teaching for more than two decades. And with this introduction, I'd like to welcome, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for coming. And I also request you to begin the lecture today.
Thank you. In fact, today's discussion would be on cosmopolitanism and internationalism. As a discourse, which is basically picking up momentum world over, but particularly in the context of India. Cosmopolitanism and internationalism acquires a special significance because, as it is well known, that two of the eminent thinkers of modern India, Rabindranath Tagore and Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, they argued for internationalism and cosmopolitanism in a period when there was an ascendancy of the idea of nation and nationalism. So in fact, on the one hand, they remained patriotic to their land, and they espoused the cause of nation and nationalism, but nonetheless, they believed that the human race would be safer and happier if the entire world moves in direction of internationalism. So that is something very significant today, because they were arguing at a time when the entire world was basically enamored of this nationalist ideology. So this way, India and Indian contribution of Indian thinkers is very significant. But we'll come to this issue later. But to begin with, I would like to divide my entire presentation into four or five different parts, spanning over a long period in history, because this idea of cosmopolitanism, that is the global or moral community, the entire idea of belongingness, not to any narrow identity, but something which is more universal. One can say this global moral community, the idea of global moral community, which is to some extent synonymous with the idea of cosmopolitanism, because the two words are very significant. The cosmos, in fact, this entire thing can be traced back to the ancient Greek period, when the Stoics were perhaps the first well-known cosmopolitan thinkers, when they talked about a different set of different type of belongingness of human beings in society. So the appropriate way to start a discussion on cosmopolitanism would be to first of all have a look at the idea in ancient time, that how this idea of cosmopolitanism was conceived then. And then it was not only the ancient Greeks, but even in India, this famous dictum, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the entire world is a family, in fact symbolizes the same thing, which basically this idea of cosmos in the Greek period or in the ideas of Stoics one can see. So this way, in fact, we have to start the entire thing from the point of view of how the ancient society looked at this idea, and then we'll move on to the modern part, that how in modern period this entire discourse of cosmopolitanism was replaced with a different set of ideas, which were considered to be more useful and effective for articulating, for realizing the values of human race. And that was basically the idea of nation and nationalism. So one can say that in modern period, instead of cosmopolitanism, it was nationalism which was the dominant ideology, dominant discourse. But nonetheless, one shouldn't deny the contribution of some eminent thinkers of the West, particularly Immanuel Kant, who basically argued for a cosmopolitan outlook or cosmopolitan worldview. So this way one can say that there were ideas even modern times which looked at things in a very cosmopolitan way, but nonetheless the dominant ideology was ideology of nation and nationalism. Now, after this modern period, we have had this the post-colonial, one can say, particularly in the countries who got independence after long struggle against you know, British rule or the French rule, or for that matter, whichever European country had colonized them. So this struggle, anti-colonial struggle in these countries, led to their independence and freedom. And therefore, the post-colonial world had a different take on this matter. On the one hand, they were basically grappling with this issue of nation and nationalism, because, you know, on the one hand, they had taken up this challenge to prove that they could also become a nation like Western societies, Western countries, because this was the challenge which had been thrown by the imperialist rulers, that nation was basically, you know, the privilege of the Western people. And, you know, in other countries, Asia, Africa and Latin America, those conditions were not available through which, you know, people could form this identity called nation. And therefore, they had only one option to reel under those sectarian and narrow identities like ethnicity, caste, community, and so on and so forth. So on the one hand, we find that this quest for nationhood was there. But on the other hand, at the same time, interestingly, we find that there was also an attempt to rise above the sectarian interests, rise above narrow interests, and basically enter into some sort of exchange with the larger world community, and to share their views, to share their feelings, to basically to empathize with the conditions of those countries which are still reeling under colonial rule, and so on and so forth. So one can say that a kind of cosmopolitan outlook characterize some of the post-colonial societies, and India stands out here, because India's first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru perhaps championed this type of politics or this type of viewpoint, and therefore entire non-aligned movement which he basically spearheaded and led, that non-aligned movement also symbolized that type of outlook, that how, you know, world peace could be thought of, how a basically non-militarized, peaceful world order could be visualized, how the countries of the South, particularly those who were underdeveloped, could come together, could have exchange of ideas and views, and could be form some sort of a kind of bloc, based on shared meanings and shared values. So this type of approach was there, but of course it was, one can say, a kind of radical cosmopolitanism, because this cosmopolitanism was based on two important considerations. Number one, without negating or rejecting the idea of nation and nationhood, it was trying to basically extricate this thing from the stranglehold of, or from the grips of narrow sectarianism in which, you know, some of the countries were sleeping. For example, even in India, one can say that nationalism had multiple discourses, multiple ideologies, and some of them wanted to turn it into a kind of jingoism. But on the other hand, there was also an attempt to, on the one hand, engage with this nation and nationhood, and then take it in a direction of more international internationalism and cosmopolitanism. So that was a post-colonial thing. And then at the same time, when we talk of internationalism, then one cannot forget the contributions of Marxism here, because the Karl Marx was perhaps one of the most eminent internationalists, because he believed in a kind of system which was above this national division of territories, and therefore this proletarian revolution, the communist revolution at the international scale, the vision of a world communism, the communism at the larger scale, cutting across these national boundaries. In fact, that was perhaps the vision of a internationalist framework. And this is what we know as basically the Marxism and its entire quest to create a kind of world order or world system, or one can say that a kind of society free of exploitation and oppression, where basically those human values should prevail, for which humanity is best known for, that is equality, justice, freedom and so on and so forth. So this proletarian revolution, the idea of a world, you know, the communism at the world level, I mean world scale, international scale, these things were basically the characteristics of this type of idea and ideology, which was basically propagated by Karl Marx and some of his followers. So this was another strand so far as this internationalism and cosmopolitanism is concerned. And then, apart from this Marxism and, Marxism and to some extent one can say Leninism, because after revolution was brought in Soviet Union, in fact, Lenin spearheaded this move to basically support the communist revolution in different parts of the world and therefore help them liberating from the clutches of imperialism and colonialism and create a communist regime at the larger international level. So this was another thing. But apart from this, there are two other important significant strands within this cosmopolitan thinking that also deserves attention, and that is something which one can put it as idea beyond nation and nationalism. And it is here that Tagore and Gandhi become very important, that how they try to theorize or how they try to reflect on this idea of cosmopolitanism. But finally, in fact, we should also not forget what is happening today in contemporary times in name of cosmopolitanism or in name of internationalism, and this is best known as the idea of globalization. Now, for last 20 years or so, what we are witnessing today, a kind of thrust in direction of globalized world, that entire world is becoming one family. In fact, this slogan that we have to think, globally and act locally, in fact, this symbolizes that how entire world is getting connected and how entire world is basically shrinking into one small family. And the most important factor which has been attributed to have basically ignited this revolution is the communication revolution, because it's the communication, changes in mode of communication, which has basically brought the entire world closer to each other. So therefore, this entire process of globalization, which is going on in contemporary times, is also characterized by certain ideas which are basically in tune with this idea of cosmopolitanism. So much so that there are many recent scholars, mostly coming from the liberal political thinking, they argue that we have to revive the old philosophical cosmopolitanism, because we have to basically move in a direction of a kind of global community, a community, ethical community, where basically there has to be shared interest, mutuality and so on and so forth. See, globalization basically to some extent verges on this idea of internationalism and cosmopolitanism, but one should not forget that there are a lot of critiques of this globalization as well, because what is believed that is globalization is trying to cover in name of this cosmopolitanism and internationalism certain other facts which are very which are quite crucial for the oppressed nations of the world, because this globalization is based on the greed, the globalization is based on the entire forces, the market forces, which are trying to dominate the world, which are trying to impose its hegemony on the oppressed people, oppressed nations, and therefore, in order to cover that process, different type of philosophical ideas are brought into discussion, and cosmopolitanism, comes handy so far as this, desire to cover this thing is concerned. So, this way one can say that these are 5-6 different perspectives through which one can look at this idea of cosmopolitanism and internationalism. To begin with, I think that first of all, let's have a look at this ancient, idea of cosmopolitanism, that how it started, what was basically the idea or spirit behind it. Now, as I mentioned that, one has to trace this entire thing from the ancient Greek period. And here, the Stoics, are quite significant, and therefore, in fact, you know, for them, this cosmopolitanism meant the idea of a global moral community. And if by this global moral community, they meant that the human beings belong to this community because of the universal relationship based on reason. So, in fact, basically, this was the rationalism, the reason. Human beings endowed with reason were capable to enter in this type of relationship, the relationship of global moral community. Now, when you know this cosmos was posited against the polis, the two words which frequently occur in the political discourse in the ancient Greek, that is the cosmos and the polis. The cosmos symbolized basically world citizens, basically a kind of mutuality or kind of shared meanings of people at the larger level, beyond narrow, local, and basically sectarian. Whereas the polis basically implied local affiliation, whereas the cosmos implied the more universal affiliation. So this way we can see that in ancient times, particularly this conflict between the cosmos and the polis was quite significant, so much so that one can say that it was perhaps most important divide in the history of ideas at that time. Now, by cosmos, as I have mentioned, they meant ideal order of the world, whereas by polis, they meant the empirical social existence of the people. So this way they demarcated the two things. The cosmos stood for more universal, more rational, something which was more ethical, whereas the polis existed or implied something more mundane, more sectarian, more related to the everyday life of the people. So this is how they made distinction, and therefore when they compared some of them the cosmos and the polis, particularly Stoics, they basically privileged cosmos over the polis, and they believed that it is always a moral community, world moral community, which is a cherished ideal for human beings. So therefore this is how they try to look at this idea of cosmopolitanism. They basically equated polis with greed, injustice, whereas by the cosmos, they believed that it stood for universal reason, virtue, eros. And therefore, in fact, this way one can say that they definitely privileged cosmos over the polis. Now, this cosmopolitanism, therefore, one can say that in ancient time started as a philosophical and moral universalism. Now, it was not only confined to the ancient Greek, as I have mentioned that even in India, you can see this coming through such, statement, the Vasudev Kutumbakam, that entire world is one community. I mean, entire human race is one. There is no division among it. There has to be no demarcation based on other identities, narrow sectarian identities based on blood, kinship, ethnicity, and so on and so forth. Because so far as human beings are concerned, they are one by their race. So therefore, this way, in fact, this was common to both West and the East. And therefore, what happened that this type of this type of worldview, one can see in a lot of scriptures, a lot of writings which come from the ancient period. Even in India, you can see, one can cite number of lines from the Upanishad and other scriptures or the texts where you can find such statements coming very frequently, where the entire human race is posited as one without any division, essential division among them. So in fact, this entire ancient period, therefore, one can say that was characterized by this type of worldview as well, apart from the other worldview. For example, as you have seen, that there are also arguments for polis, but nonetheless, there are also arguments for the cosmos. So, in fact, from ancient times, when we moved in direction of medieval and modern, we find that there was some transition, there was some sort of modification, or one can say that lot of developments, social, economic, political, cultural developments, which basically started taking a different shape, so much so that in modern time, what we find that this entire cosmology, in fact, entire science to look at this, the world society or the world, entire science to look at this world, human world, humanity, in fact, underwent changes. And therefore, those changes were best reflected in the rise of the modern and the rise of the modern period, particularly the two, three important developments which took place in modern times characterized those changes. And one of the most important development was rise of capitalism, rise of modernity, and along with that, the emergence of the modern nation state. So what happened at 1648, the Treaty of Westphalia, which is very significant for the rise and growth of modern nation states, where for the first time the four essential attributes of the state were defined: territory, population, sovereignty, and government. So this way one can say that the state comes into the idea of modern state comes into existence along with the idea of modern nation. So this nation state emerging, and along with nation state, you have this powerful ideology of nation is also taking shape around this time. And this became the dominant creed of the period, the modern period, nationalism. And therefore, what we find that in modern times, it is basically on the one hand, the perhaps the most dominant urge among the humanity. On the other hand, this ideology was also responsible for a lot of violence, a lot of conflict, a lot of problems, which basically characterize this period. So therefore, one can say that entire thing started revolving around this idea of nation and nationalism. Whereas earlier you have seen that this cosmopolitan worldview was equally significant. But in modern times, what we find that this type of idea became dominant. Now, it is here that one should also remember that how this modern period, particularly in the West, tried to look at the idea of freedom. And it is here that how freedom was associated with nation, how freedom was associated with nation state, and how it was believed that the freedom for human beings can be realized only at the level of the state and and its ideological attribute, that is the nation. So in fact, this way one can say that this entire idea of freedom got tagged with this entity called nation state, and therefore it was a kind of a drift from the cosmopolitanism to nationalism. Now, it is a different matter that this also, synchronized with the rise of rise and growth of capitalism and the entire imperialist machine, which tried to spread, this capital throughout the world through market, and thereby to colonize, try to colonize some weaker people, weaker societies, weaker races, and thereby create a different structure in the world. So on the one hand, he tried to give this impression that the entire world was connected, these ideas, in fact, this entire, attempt, ideological attempt on the part of liberalism to project itself as universalism, that the liberal ideas, liberal values are universal in their application and validity, and if anyone, any society, any country wants progress and freedom, it has to basically traverse on the path of progress shown by the West. So in fact, this liberal universalism, on the one hand, we find that coming as a kind of ideological hegemony on the weaker nations, weaker races, weaker societies to show the path for the future. On the other hand, it was a camouflaged attempt, one can say, to basically hide the real greed behind this entire process, because it was basically an attempt to create of an alliance between capitalism and liberalism, and thereby to promote this imperialism and colonialism, or basically push the forces of capital from the center to the peripheries, that is from developed to the underdeveloped world, and protecting it and justifying it and legitimizing it through the ideology of liberalism. So in fact, this is something which has been critiqued later by this post-colonial take on nation and nationalism. When they talk of universalism, they critique it precisely on this basis, that liberalism's entire claim of universalism and liberalism's entire claim of cosmopolitanism, even in contemporary times, in era of globalization, is totally sham and phony, because it is there in order to hide the real process, the real practices which are basically latent within it, and those practices are meant to exploit and to oppress the people, not to integrate them in the larger moral community of the world. So this is a post-colonial critique, which is a very, very powerful critique even today, when globalization and globalism is again basically put forth as a cosmopolitanism of our times. So we'll come to this issue later. So what we find that in modern period, this nation and nationalism became very significant ideology. Now it is here that, as I mentioned, that the entire discourse of freedom got associated with this. And here, in fact, one important thinker should be remembered, and is Hegel, German philosopher Hegel, particularly his philosophy of rights, and particularly the way Hegel talked of political freedom. In fact, it is very significant here, because for freedom, not only in Hegel, but in the Hegel was, one can say, the high priest of this entire discourse. In the West, the freedom was basically based on twin foundations. One was the state and its institutions, and another was the market, private property, and individual rights. So these were the two foundations of freedom. That these were the only channels through which human beings could achieve their freedom. Here we find that in this, in this way, one can say that the entire foundation was basically built in a manner in which a kind of duality was created, duality of identity, that is self and the other, in the sense that there is no identity without having a corresponding other. So therefore, entire identity of human beings was basically divided into two parts, the self and the other. The othering was very significant, because in order to have identity of self, one needs a other. And it is in this context that people believe that entire freedom, particularly the people in the East, particularly the thinkers of India and many Eastern countries, they believed that the entire discourse of freedom in the East, in the West, was basically fallacious, because the freedom for the self implied the loss of freedom for the other. It couldn't be that the freedom of self could be achieved without basically subjecting the other to humiliation, to harassment, and to oppression. So this way, this entire freedom, the way it was conceptualized, the foundation on which it was anchored, and the way it got associated with nation and state, in fact, one can say, was a total digression from what we talk of in name of cosmopolitanism as a world moral community. I mean, the citizens of the world, where we talk of one family of humanity based on human values and ethical freedom. So this way, this modern concept of identity basically became a fractured identity, a divided identity, and nation perhaps symbolized this type of discourse of freedom and identity at that time. And it is not just a chance that in modern times, therefore, Hegel was a very important and prominent philosopher, thinker, whose ideas were quite useful and significant for those who believed in this type of discourse. Now, for example, the Indian discourse of freedom, if one makes little bit of comparison with this Western counterpart, was at deviance with this position. For example, the Indian freedom, instead of positing self against the other, instead of basically refining the self, always talked of ethical freedom and the freedom through renunciation, effacement of self. And therefore, the entire concept of the sannyasi, the renouncer, was basically part of this discourse. So therefore, one can say that there were many, many thinkers, even at that time, modern times, both in the East and the West, which didn't subscribe to this view. For example, Hegel was talking about this type of freedom, whereas we have another thinker in the West, for example, Immanuel Kant, whose ideas are quite significant even from the point of view of cosmopolitan worldview. And a lot of people basically today are looking towards him, trying to find out resources from resources in Kant to basically theorize this idea of cosmopolitanism. But what I'm trying to put before you at the moment, that in modern times one finds that the entire the discourse of cosmopolitanism took a turn towards more sectarianism, towards more narrow considerations, and nation and nationalism. It was basically the period of nation and nationalism, the identity around it, and therefore, in fact, this idea of world moral community took a back seat. Now, what happened that unfortunately, this modern period was also characterized by rise of imperialism and colonialism. In fact, as it is well known that how West basically colonized both Asia, Africa, and countries of Latin America. And therefore, this imperialism and colonialism went hand in hand with this capitalism and liberalism. Now, what happened that after this imperialism and colonialism created their own contradictions, people rose in revolt, and powerful anti-colonial movement took place in many of these countries. And finally, what happened when they got independence, what happened that they started a different type of political discourse. And here, in fact, one is reminded of what happened in name of non-aligned movement in world politics. Now, what happened that 1940s is remembered as a period of decolonization when most of the countries of Asia, Africa, and Latin America got independence from the colonial rule. And that was also the time when the entire world was gripped with another conflict, that was the Cold War. Even after having fought two world wars, the entire world was basically in throes of crisis. And the World War and the clouds of the Third World War were on the horizon. It was in this context that the Third World countries, as they were popularly called, because the countries who had gained independence after long struggle, they felt that the only way they could protect their their freedom, which they had won after long struggle, by basically keeping themselves aloof from this power politics, the bloc politics, which was the characteristic of the world then. That was the Cold War politics. And therefore, what happened that when this entire world was in the grip of this Cold War politics, the countries like India, basically they decided to have a different type of political journey. They didn't want to join any of the blocs. Rather they wanted to basically start a different type of campaign for world peace and world progress. And this was basically at that time called non-aligned movement. Now, in fact, India's first Prime Minister Nehru is often remembered for his contribution in charting out this course of political action for these underdeveloped countries. Now, his position, therefore, is at times characterized by a radical cosmopolitanism. Radical cosmopolitanism because, on the one hand, they had a nationalist urge because they had basically been denied freedom on precisely this basis that they were not nation or they were not capable of becoming a nation. So, on the one hand, it was a challenge to them to prove that they could also become a nation, and they successfully tried to accomplish this task, and they accomplished it also. They basically got freedom, and then they tried to constitute themselves as a nation. But a nation which they believed would be a progressive nation, a nation which will not be based on exclusion of others, a nation which will not be driven by the desire and greed to basically subjugate other people. Therefore, on the one hand, they wanted to constitute themselves into a nation, a progressive nation, without having any trace of sectarianism. On the other hand, they also wanted to have a shared relationship with other nations of the world. So this basically, self and the other, this distinction of freedom, as we have discussed in the context of this Hegel and the West. In fact, they wanted to simply discard, and they wanted to create a different, you know, ambit, a different framework of freedom, where on the one hand they could have a national identity, a kind of identity for the self, but on the other hand, an identity which would not militate against the interest of the other. It will be based on the shared meanings, shared relationship, a larger world community. And therefore, the two things which happened are quite significant here. On the one hand, they tried to basically build the foundation of nation state in these countries, and therefore we often hear this idea of the project of nation building project. But on the other hand, they tried to force two different types of relationship. The relationship with the other nations of the world, particularly the nations who were the oppressed nations. The oppressed nations, for example, the nations who had been subjected to colonial rule like India, the nations mostly in Asia, Africa and Latin America, the oppressed nations. In fact, therefore, you know, one can here remember that how in 1927, when the Congress was held in Brussels of oppressed nationalities, and Nehru as a leader of Indian National Congress had participated in it, perhaps that was etched in his memory. And therefore, even after the independence, Nehru didn't leave that behind, and he tried to continue or carry forward that legacy, what happened in Brussels in 1927. And therefore, you know, what he did, that the first thing after India gaining independence, in fact, not even India had not fully become independent, but the process was on, that first thing he did, that Asian Relations Conference was held in New Delhi in 1947. That was basically, that symbolized that how India wanted to forge closer relationship with the Asian nations. But that was not all. In fact, what happened, that immediately after 1947, an attempt was made to have a similar relationship with both Asian and African countries. So therefore, a kind of a larger committee of nations, particularly based on shared interests, mutuality of interests, shared meanings, commonality of concerns, and therefore in 1955 Bandung Conference, and it is called Afro-Asian Nations. So from Asia, it basically graduated to Africa and Asia, Afro-Asian, and from 1955, from Afro-Asian, it subsequently graduated to Africa, Asia and Latin America, that is 1961, the Belgrade, when this non-aligned movement started. So now you have the three continents coming together. So therefore, it is basically, on the one hand, quest us to create a foundation for nation and state. On the other hand, a simultaneous attempt to forge a closer relationship with other nations of the world. So that is something quite significant. In other words, one can say the south-south, you know, exchange, south-south interaction, the south-south, you know, cooperation. So that was basically one. And secondly, it was not only south-south, but also north and the south. And therefore, the non-aligned movement basically gave a call for world peace, world order. What it symbolized, that it didn't want only peace and progress for the south, but also for the north, but wanted north to basically take certain responsibilities so far as the progress, freedom, and development of the south was concerned. So it was a different type of worldview, a worldview which was basically totally, you know, different from the worldview of certain other nationalists, even in India at that time, who wanted to turn Indian nation or entire nationalist discourse in a different direction, a more Jingoist, sectarian nationalism, the way it was in the West earlier in modern times, in 17th, 18th century. But nonetheless, the dominant discourse, one can say, the discourse which one can say the constitutional discourse. Because, you know, in Indian constitution also, this internationalism, the global responsibility, the cosmopolitanism and the worldview, you know, this type of worldview, it finds a place in the constitutional structure of the country. So in fact, one can say that it is here this radical cosmopolitanism becomes very significant, and the contribution of Nehru is also equally significant. But at the same time, what we find, that this post-colonial thing, in fact, have two different connotations. One, as you have seen, the radical cosmopolitanism. I will come back to it later. But this post-colonialism as basically a critique of this cosmopolitanism of West, or one can say the cosmopolitanism as championed by the liberal political theory, is different from the, you know, radical cosmopolitanism, or one can say the political cosmopolitanism of the third world countries, as is, you know, we have discussed in context of Nehru. Now, this post-colonialism, as it is called in social science parlance, in fact, it is basically against the Eurocentric universalism of the West. And it is believed that in name of cosmopolitanism and internationalism, West has been trying to package basically its own identity, its own interests as basically universalism. So basically particularism of West comes in garb of universalism, and this post-colonial approach tries to, you know, expose or to tries to basically, you know, to basically, you know, lay bare the foundation of this type of, you know, particularism coming as universalism. Now, it is here that enlightenment and its most important fruit, that is modernity, and the way the two try to basically promote colonialism, the interconnection between all these three things is also highlighted. Now, it is also believed that liberalism and imperialism, they were part of the same process, whereas liberalism always tried to justify imperialism ideologically, and it is called the cultural imperialism. They try to justify this imperialism in name of progress, in name of history, in name of freedom. And therefore, it was always argued that this liberalism is a universal value, and all countries of the world have to basically tread this path if they really want freedom and progress. And in this process, what was done was precisely that this colonial interests were promoted and instituted in most of these countries. So basically, this post-colonialism tries to basically go beyond, or in fact, it tries to look beneath the foundation of this liberal universalism and tries to figure out that how the cultural matrix of this entire discourse was basically integrally associated with both imperialism and colonialism, and therefore the political freedom and economic freedom would not be enough for these countries, the countries of the third world, the post-colonial countries. But in fact, one has to also find an alternative to this cultural subjugation. Therefore, this post-colonialism is a very powerful critique of this type of cosmopolitanism, which even today we find coming in a big way. Even in era of globalization, we'll discuss when we'll come to this issue of globalization. So this is one brand of post-colonial take on this cosmopolitanism. On the other hand, the another brand which I have discussed in context of radical cosmopolitanism, it was altogether different. It was basically based on the recognition of the hierarchy of power. It was based on the recognition of the forces of capital. It was based on the correct assessment, understanding of global capital market and the process through which they were trying to basically colonize the world again. Therefore, 1945 onward, the new world order which was being created, in fact, the countries like India under leadership of Nehru, when they talked of this cosmopolitan world you know, view, they believed two things: that they were a genuine cosmopolitans in the sense that they wanted a world government, they wanted world citizenship, they wanted a kind of world order based on equality, justice and freedom. They believed in democratic values, they believed a democratized world order, but they also wanted a radical redistribution of resources, world resources. They also questioned this hierarchy of power, and therefore they believed that only a radical reordering and restructuring of world could lead to a truly international order based on freedom and democracy. Therefore, this type of radical cosmopolitanism championed by Nehru, championed by non-aligned movement, and championed by many other countries, whether it was Ghana of Nkrumah or Egypt of Nasir, or, you know, Sukarno or Tito of Yugoslavia and Indonesia, they always argued along this line, a line which was basically championed by Nehru. So therefore, non-aligned movement, one can say that basically championed this point of view, the point of view of radical cosmopolitanism, radical restructuring of world power, radical restructuring of world resources, redistribution of resources, and democratization of world order, and therefore creation of a world community based on mutuality, based on shared meaning, shared interest, without exclusion based on, you know, oppression or disposition. So this was basically a radical communitarianism, a political communitarianism of the third world countries or the post-colonial world, and there was also an academic, post-colonialism, which took on this cosmopolitanism, universalism, coming in garb of liberalism and capitalism, as we have just now discussed. But apart from this post-colonialism and, you know, this radical cosmopolitanism, we also find that there was a powerful critique coming from alternative tradition. That tradition is normally known as Marxism. In fact, Marxism, from the very beginning, believed and talked of internationalism and international order. It believed in, international proletariat revolution, and it believed in the working class led movement in the world, which will create one society, so based on equality, justice. It will be oppression free society, and this will be a communist society. So basically, it was the internationalism of this sort which characterized this ideology, and they believed that only through a world revolution that human beings could be made free of oppression. But unfortunately, what happened, that revolution took place in Soviet Union, it was not a world revolution, and when the Soviet Bolshevik revolution took place, Soviet Union also gradually, when it was founded, it moved in direction of this Western paradigm of nation and nationalism. It is a different matter that even after revolution, Lenin tried to basically join hands with some of the oppressed nationalities and to give support, both political and moral support, for their freedom. But nonetheless, the entire framework which came into existence in Soviet Union was much different from what this idea of internationalism symbolized at that time. So therefore, instead of world revolution, it became a nationalist revolution, it became a revolution in one country, one nation, and therefore that was a major deviation from this stated position of Marxism. So now this Marxism and internationalism therefore suffered a setback so far as this worldview is concerned. Now after this Marxism and setback to Marxism and internationalism, what we find that this entire idea of nation and nationalism, which basically were trying to subvert this project of cosmopolitanism, was subjected to severest critique in India by two eminent modern Indian thinkers. One was Tagore, another was Gandhi. Now Tagore, from the very beginning, was very uncomfortable with this idea of nation and nationalism. It doesn't mean that he was not a patriot, he was, but he believed that the freedom gained through this type of framework, the framework which was Western in its origin. That doesn't mean that Tagore believed that anything which is Western is to be rejected, and this is here, and it is here that we find that there is a difference between Tagore and Gandhi. The famous debate between Tagore and Gandhi on modernization is quite significant here. Tagore didn't believe that enlightenment by its very nature was bad. He believed that there are many fruits of enlightenment, but he always believed that nation definitely is not one, because he believed that nation, by creating this identity, which is basically a kind of, fragmented identity, identity which is based on self and the other, is basically against human spirit. And therefore, the human urge for ethical freedom cannot be attained within the framework of nation and nationalism. Therefore, it is well known that Tilak was not also quite comfortable when the Swadeshi movement started. He rather was very uncomfortable when non-cooperation movement was launched by Gandhi. So much so that when Tilak visited, when Tagore visited you know, Japan in 1916, and later on even China. Some of the lectures he delivered, which have come to us as, you know, lectures on nationalism. In fact, he was very critical of nationalism. And that made even the, you know, the host in Japan, in form of Japan, quite uncomfortable, because Japan was basically moving on that path of building a powerful nation on pattern of the West. And therefore, you know, Tagore's criticism of nation didn't go down well with them. But nonetheless, you know, Tagore stood his ground, and he continued to deliberate and basically reflect on this issue. And therefore, in fact, 2-3 novels which he wrote are quite significant, where his ideas on nation and nationalism, and to some extent one can say through his critique of nation and nationalism, he is building the foundation for a world moral community or cosmopolitanism, internationalism, where, you know, human beings rise above the narrow divisions, narrow interests based on nationhood, and they move in direction of a more universal idea, the cherished values of humanity, where they could attain the true freedom. So that is basically a kind of cosmopolitanism which was championed by Tagore. Some of the novels which he wrote, particularly the two important novels are to be noted here. One is Goa, another is Ghore Bahar in Bangla. In fact, Home in the World. So one find that in through these novels and through other writings, some of the speeches which delivered in Japan, in China, and so on and so forth, Tagore consistently believed that human beings could not be happier within this framework of nation and nationalism. They had to move in direction of a larger, you know, unified entity in form of a board more in form of international order or cosmopolitan worldview. So this was Tagore. Now coming to Gandhi, to some extent, you know, there are a lot of differences between Tagore and Gandhi on some of the issues. For example, for Gandhi, enlightenment, modernity, and you know, such things were essentially bad for humanity, where Tagore perhaps had a different type of take on this. He had a qualified objection, but Gandhi, you know, basically wanted to paint the entire picture in such a manner that enlightenment categories were by nature, you know, based on violence, and they were basically against the spirit of humanity. Though Tagore also associated nation and nationalism with militarism, industrialism, but nonetheless he believed that enlightenment had also many good things to contribute. But so far Gandhi is concerned, Gandhi's idea on nation is also quite nuanced. For example, on the one hand, he was leading a powerful national movement. But in fact, one should remember that doesn't mean that Gandhi believed that nation and nationalism were the only way that humanity could attain freedom. To the extent that when one reads Gandhi's Vinswaras, one doesn't find the occurrence of the word nation. Rather, he was more comfortable with the term civilization, which he defined quite frequently, both in Gujarati and English, as good conduct. So therefore, nation as a category, Gandhi was never comfortable like Tagore. But nonetheless, Gandhi also believed in a larger world community based on human values, whether it could be the Ram Raj of his utopia, or it could be a different type of community, but nonetheless a community which would be beyond this nationhood. Now, one find that, you know, when we come to Gandhi, what we find that on the issue of nation, one finds little bit, you know, some confusing positions at times, but nonetheless, one thing is very clear that so far as this militaristic modern nationhood of West is concerned, Gandhi was quite close to Tagore in terms of the urge for ethical freedom and the freedom which would basically take humanity closer to its values. So this way we find that both Tagore and Gandhi talked of this type of cosmopolitan worldview. Even in Gandhi, we often hear this concept of oceanic circle, which reminds one of the Stoics' use of concentric circle, the concentric circle of human affiliations, as Stoics used to put in ancient Greek period. Now, this concentric circle begins with the smallest, and it is drawn around the self and end with the largest, that is the humanity, going through various intermediary circles. This is the concentric circle as it was used in ancient time. Now, Gandhi also often used these oceanic currents, the currents in the ocean, starting with the small and then moving towards the bigger circles. This is how he perhaps looked this world society, that individual as the unit, the smallest unit, and then moving toward the larger circle of humanity based on human values, the values which are the most cherished values of both humanity and society. So this way, in fact, both we find Tagore and Gandhi to some extent try to propagate this type of worldview, the worldview which one can call a cosmopolitan worldview, a kind of moral community of the world, the citizens of the world. So therefore, we find on the one hand, this political position on cosmopolitanism was articulated by Nehru and the entire Third World Movement, which we have discussed. On the other hand, the philosophical and ethical part was discussed by two eminent thinkers, Tagore and Gandhi.
Thank you so much, sir, for this very interesting lecture and the idea of internationalism and cosmopolitanism that you discussed. And of course, you told us a great deal in depth about this whole discussion. And I hope we had more time for, of course, a question answer session. But since we don't have that, we would like to bring the lecture to a close. And thanks, sir, for being here. Thank you so much, sir. We really appreciate it. Also, viewers, thanks a lot for being tuned in. Keep watching. Have a wonderful day ahead.